You're watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Gardens of California. And I'm sorry, I missed the very beginning of the show. I was reading about our tree of the day so I could inform you more about it. My name is Gerald Turney and I'm your host and instructor. And this is our first class of the fall semester. And we'll cover many topics that pertain to gardening in California, particularly Southern California. So we'll look at many different issues and different species and genera and plant families. Today, we're going to be talking about how to water your garden because there's really nothing more important than how you water your garden. If you don't do it right, nothing will go right in your garden. And then we'll take a close look at the pea family. And we'll also talk about what to do this winter because the summer, we finally got some heat, it's getting warm. But the summer actually is coming to an end and not too far away. So by the end of September, we'll be in the fall. What do you do in your garden in the fall? Let's talk about that. But a number of things. We have our mystery plant, and let's take a look at our mystery plant right here. And if you recognize this plant, maybe we could close in on it. We'll show you the flowers. There are the flowers. And you notice it's covered with thorns. And they're actually, they're technically thorns or prickles, but so this is our plant of the day. If you recognize it, call in and take a guess at what you think it is. An excellent plant for Southern California, extremely drought tolerant, take full sun, and it has these really nice flowers. It'll also discourage people from messing with your plants because it bites back. So. I'm going to set this, where should I put it? Let me put it over here, not out of the way completely, right there. And so remember, we have a plant of the day. If you recognize it, give us a call. Now, some more things about the class itself. Our textbook is the Western Garden Book, Sunset Western Garden Book. This is really an excellent book for gardening in the Western United States. It's an encyclopedia of plant materials. You can look up almost any plant that we grow in Southern California or all over California, and you can read about it, read about its needs, its water needs, and any other information that would be important to know. Let me just turn this like this, Sunset Western Garden Book. At the beginning of the book, there's a section on plant uses, so plants to attract hummingbirds, plants to attract butterflies, and there's about, 18 or 19 areas where they have plant uses. The last one is plants that are resistant to Armillaria mellia or the oak root rot fungus, which is very important in many parts of California. So this is a really good book. At the back of the book, there's sections on grafting, fertilizing, pruning, and that type of thing. So this is the first book that any gardener should really pick up. Whether you need more books in order to garden is debatable. I'd like to share with you a couple other books that I brought today. These are books you probably won't want to purchase, but you might want to know about. This is Insects That Feed on Plants. Let me see if I got to read the title correctly. Insects That Feed on Trees and Shrubs by Sinclair. So I can turn this, which way should I turn it? This way to get a good look at it. Now this is really an excellent book on insects that might be feeding on your plant material. It's a fairly expensive book. And most people won't really want to get it. The price tag on the back of this says $62. But this is the kind of book that I refer to quite frequently when I want to read about a specific insect or know something more about a particular pest that is a problem in Southern California. And so that's the insects that feed on trees and shrubs. And the companion book to this is Diseases of Trees and Shrubs, also by Sinclair, or they're really editors. And so this is probably more germane to my particular expertise because I am a plant pathologist. My PhD is in plant pathology. My undergraduate degree is in botany. I went to Cal Poly Pomona to do my botany degree and UC Riverside to do my doctoral work in plant pathology working on citrus root rot. So this is an excellent book, and both of these books, if you want to take a look at them and read them, are available at the Los Angeles County Arboretum in their horticultural library. Now you can't check the book out, but you can go there and look at it and read a section, read about a particular disease or a particular insect, and get a lot of very detailed information that might assist you in dealing with that particular pest in your garden. And we're going to take a look at a lot of pests because if you water properly, if you fertilize properly, if you put your plants where they're supposed to be in your garden, talking about full sun or shade, if you pick plants that don't freeze and can tolerate where you live, things like that, then the next thing to deal with are your pests, whether they be insect pests or fungal diseases or bacterial diseases, perhaps viral diseases, whatever the problem is, you know, you got to deal with that at some point. Now, let's talk about some common stuff that you might be seeing in your garden right now. The first thing I want to show you is this sprig from my orange tree in my backyard. And I must admit, I don't really bother to control this pest very much. And I probably should try a little more diligently, but it's really not that bad for the tree once it's established. Maybe we could go to the overhead camera to get a good look at this. This is called the citrus leaf miner. Extremely common on citrus throughout Southern California. And if I can open this up to show you, now there's a few Argentine ants crawling around, which probably means I have some sucking insects in my tree as well. But if we could get in close to look at this, you can see that the leaves are all twisted and contorted and thoroughly distorted. And if you open them up and look at them flat, you can see that there's like a snake-like or serpentine pattern in the leaf that shows where the damage is actually occurring. Now this is actually a moth. It's called the citrus leaf miner. The moth lays its eggs starting in about June, and then the eggs hatch and the caterpillar or the larva goes inside the leaf and feeds inside the leaf and leaves this serpentine pattern and causes the leaves to be all twisted and contorted. Now you can see the leaves that grew in the spring, which are farther down the stem, have no leaf miner damage. It's the new growth that occurred probably in July that got heavily infested, because the actual leaf miners themselves, the moth, it's too cold in the spring for the moth to be active. And so your spring flush, you'll get no leaf miner. But by summer, you're going to get a heavy infestation of leaf miner. Otherwise, you're just really lucky if you don't have it. Now, there's a couple ways to control this. One is to put out leaf miner traps starting some point in June. In the past, I've said to put them out at the end of June, but some people have told me that really that's a little late and you probably want to put one out at the beginning of June. They're little white triangular traps with a sticky board that goes in the trap and a pheromone attractant to attract the male moths. Insects have to have a way to find each other in the environment. And typically, especially with moths and quite a few other insects, they give off what we call pheromones, or these chemicals that they can follow to find each other. The female moth gives off the sex pheromone to attract the male so that they can mate. Now, if you trap all the males, then the females will have a hard time mating and they won't be able to lay viable eggs. So it can work to put out a trap and try and trap the male moths in your yard. You need to put out a trap at some point in June, replace it in July, replace it in August, and replace it again in September. So you probably use 3 or 4 traps. And that, I've been told by a variety of people, can work very well. Unfortunately, some people have told me that it's not working in their gardens, and probably because mated females are flying in from other parts of the neighborhood. So at that point, male annihilation, or trapping all the males to prevent mating, is going to fail. So you can spray your trees also with a product called spinosad. And spinosad, or spinosad, depending on how you want to pronounce it, is organically labeled and is registered for the control of chewing insects like grasshoppers, beetles, and leaf miners. So it absorbs a little bit into the leaf, just enough that the caterpillar will get some and it'll kill it. So it's organically labeled, it has extremely low toxicity to mammals. And so if you don't want to use broad spectrum insecticides, which won't work anyway because it's inside the leaf, the caterpillar is in the leaf, and so it's not going to control it. You have to be able to get into the leaf to control it. So if you use oils and soaps, that's not going to work because it won't get to the actual insect. If you use broad spectrum insecticides like 7 or malathion, that's not going to work because it doesn't get into the leaf and it doesn't control it. So the best thing to use is spinosad. And it only lasts for about 10 days. So you'd have to spray your tree at least once a month or twice a month to get really good control if the traps aren't working that well. Now it says on the trap to hang it in the tree itself. It actually works better if you hang it on a fence on the opposite side of the property or in a non-citrus. Now, citrus leaf miner only goes to citrus. It doesn't infest any other types of plant material. So you can control this with a combination of the traps and spraying with spinosad. Whether you would need to spray once a month or twice a month may depend a lot on how many citrus trees are in your neighborhood. If there's not very many around, if you're the only one with citrus, maybe the traps will work all on their own. You can get them at Armstrong Nursery. You can order them online. The last time I heard, they were around $13 a piece. So if the traps work for you, great. You don't need to spray, but some people are telling me the traps aren't working for them, and probably because mated females are coming in from the neighborhood adjacent to them, other trees. So that's a citrus leaf miner, extremely common. Now the thing is, on the citrus leaf miner, you don't really need to control it on large mature trees that have been in the ground for many years because the leaves are still photosynthetic. They're twisted and curled, they don't look good, but they're still making food. So don't prune it off, that's not effective and that's not good for the tree. If once they're infested, you're stuck with it until next spring when you grow a whole bunch of new leaves. So the best thing to do right now is you have a lot of leaf miner on your citrus, whether you're orange or lemon or limes or whatever you're growing, is to just live with it for now. If you've got very young trees that have only been in the ground less than a year, or you just put them in the ground, or you're planning on putting in some new citrus this fall, then you do need to control it because it can slow the growth rate a little bit. And in nursery production, it is recommended you control it. But on large and mature trees and in commercial production, they don't really bother to control it. They may be spraying for other things that help them control it anyway. Now let's take a look at some peach and nectarine cuttings from my backyard again. And these all have a similar symptom. And let's go to the overhead and see if we can take a look at it. And you can see the tip of the branch has died. And actually what you'll see is this part, the end of the branch, will just hang straight down and then it will die. And there's two different moths that can cause this. And I don't know how close we can get to this, but if you can look, I doubt if you can see it unless we come in really close. There's a little tiny exit hole right here in the twig, right there, there's a little hole. That means that the moth is already gone. Now there's two moths that can do this to peach and nectarine. And one is called the oriental fruit moth, and the other is called the peach twig borer. And both of these do the same thing. The egg is laid, the moths fly around starting in early spring, or some point in the spring, and then they lay their eggs, and the eggs hatch and burrow into the stem, into the twig, when it's soft and tender, and then they cause the tip to die. Now, this isn't too bad for the tree in general. So the tip borer, the peach twig borer, is not that big a pest, it's not that big a problem. But the oriental fruit moth gets into the fruit and destroys the fruit. And I don't have any fruit with me. My peach trees are all done. So if you find a larva at the center of your peaches or nectarines, all the way next to the pit or the seed, that's almost certainly the oriental fruit moth. And to control that, to prevent it from getting into your fruit, can be difficult. So you can spray with a variety of products. Now in commercial production, they use pheromones to disrupt mating. They have the pheromone from the female moth, and they put it on twist ties and they put it on the trees throughout the orchard. Then there's so much pheromone in the air, the males can't find the females. That's mating disruption. They may also employ some sprays, a couple things that control caterpillars. One of them is called BT, Bacillus thuringiensis. So if you want to start, and BT is organically labeled and it controls primarily caterpillars. There are some BT strains that also control mosquitoes and midges, which are aquatic insects, of course, and they can be a problem in certain settings. Of course, mosquitoes are always a problem. But for the most part, BT is used to control caterpillars, and it's a bacteria, Bacillus thuringiensis. You can buy it under the name Caterpillar Killer, and if you look at the label, you'll see it says contains Bacillus thuringiensis. It's the active ingredient. It's a white powder. You mix it with water. You spray it on your plant. The caterpillars eat it, and then they stop feeding immediately and die within a fairly short period, maybe a day or two. But you've got to have this on the plant when the eggs hatch and the caterpillars start to go into the twig or into the fruit. So commercially, they put out traps, and when they find the first adult moths flying in their orchard, then they start accumulating what they call degree days. It's a measure of heat. And when they reach a certain number of degree days, then they know to spray. And they can spray with either spinosad or they can spray with BT. And so that's very, very critically timed sprays. It's very difficult to do for a homeowner or a backyard gardener. So in general, if you want to really, if you've had a big problem with this on your peaches or nectarines, because it doesn't go to the other stone fruits nearly as much, you know, apricots, plums, cherries, things like that. This is not a big problem on them. This is almost exclusively on peaches and nectarines. It's the oriental fruit moth. And so you could spray, but you're going to need to spray about twice a month. If you're using spinosad, you could probably spray twice a month, probably starting in April, because you're going to get your first flight in March at some point. And then if it's warm, you know, the eggs will start hatching at some point by the end of March or early April. So you're going to need some sprays out early spring, and then you're going to need to continue spraying throughout the spring in order to keep these off your peaches and nectarines. The damage to the tips is really insignificant. But you'll probably also, if you're controlling the oriental fruit moth, you will also be controlling the peach twig borer as well. So this is common on nectarines and peaches. If you're not controlling it, you'll definitely get it. Our next pest I want to show you is from plum. And there's two things to see on this. Let's go to our overhead. And you can see this severe twisting and distortion here on these leaves on this plum. But if you look at the back, the leaves are pretty much okay. They got a little burn on their edges, and that might have just been the heat we've had recently. I don't think it's sunburn. I mean, I don't think it's salt burn, but it could be. So anyway, this twisting and contorting is due to aphid feeding. Aphids can also cause leaves to be twisted and contorted. And the way you kind of know for sure is you take one leaf and you open it up. And what you'll find underneath the leaf are little cast skins from aphids. So this is real typical of aphid feeding on a variety of plants. Your citrus will also get the same problem. Usually in March, if you get heavy aphid infestation on citrus in March, it'll cause the leaves to be twisted and curled. Once they're like that and they mature like that, they're going to be twisted and curled the rest of the season. So it doesn't look so good. And it's a good idea to keep those sucking insects off your trees. Now, oils and soaps are very good for controlling aphids almost on any plant material. The caveat is that you can't use oils if it's over 90 degrees. Oils are primarily a spring and fall pest control option. Soaps can be used pretty much year round, although you don't want to spray in the hottest part of the day. Spray in the early morning or the late evening. If it's, you know, a hot day, 95, 100 degrees out, you want to avoid spraying the plants when it's extreme heat. So let's look at some other samples, and then we're going to get on to what we're going to talk about today. Let's see what we got here. This is rose leaves. And if we could take a look at this on the overhead, there's a couple things you can learn from this. Now, you can see the damage to the rose leaves themselves. And this is, if you look at the back, you can see that it's been stripped of the actual green material. Now, there's either a beetle caused this or a slug. There's a rose slug, and there are beetles that will do this as well. So this is not caused by a sucking insect. This is caused by some type of chewing insect. The point here is, if you look at this leaf here, you'll see that the older leaves have the damage. But if you go to the end, the new growth, there's no damage. The new growth is fine. So what's that telling you? It's telling you that the pest is gone. The damage was done probably a month or two ago, or maybe is in early spring, and whatever was causing this damage is now gone. So there's no point in spraying anymore. And if you were to spray, you would need something that controls the chewing insect. So you would probably want to use spinosad, which has become a real standard for a lot of these highly mobile chewing insects. That's the challenge with chewing insects, is they come and go rapidly. They're highly mobile. Sucking insects tend to just sit there and suck on the plant. Or grasshoppers chew on the plant and then take off. So that's probably a beetle. And which beetle, I'm not sure, because it's gone. And it's gone, and it's not damaging the plant anymore. So the good news is you don't need to spray if the damage has stopped and the insect is gone. One last thing to show you on damage. And these are rhododendron leaves. And I grow a variety of rhododendrons. And this is saltburn. This is typical saltburn. And you can see this on a lot of plants that you either fertilize too much, or if you use something, you know, especially if you've used manure on certain plants, or in general manure. Cow manure is very salty. It can damage a lot of plant material. But you see this a lot on avocados. Avocados are very sensitive to salt burn. Rhododendrons are also going to be in that category. They don't like hard water. They don't like salty waters. We have very hard water in Southern California, and a lot of plants are very sensitive to it. And this is your typical symptom from salt burn. The tips of the leaves turn brown. Maybe the whole leaf will turn brown. And you need to leach this, the salts out. If this is in a pot, you can leach it by heavily irrigating the pot. You could go get purified water to leach the pot. It's not that very expensive, about 25 cents a gallon, and a couple gallons would leach most pots. Now, today we're going to talk about two other things. We're going to talk about how to water your garden, and we're going to talk about peas. Because peas are grown in the winter in Southern California, beans are grown in the summer. Pea is one of your really, really wonderful winter vegetable crops you can grow. But let's talk about watering first. I want to talk about watering because watering is so important. There's a handful of concepts that you need to understand about watering. One is your evapotranspiration rate, or your ET rate. ET, or evapotranspiration, is the total water loss from the soil due to evaporation from the surface of the soil and water passing through the plant and going out of into the air. So it's called evapotranspiration. Historically, we know how much water we lose on a daily, weekly, monthly basis, and seasonal basis. So in the spring, let's concentrate on the hot inland valleys, and then we'll talk a little bit about the coast and the deserts. In the hot inland valleys, you lose an inch a week in the spring and the fall, and 2 inches a week in the summer, historically. We might have been a little lower than that with the cool season, a cool summer, beginning of summer we had this year. But in general, it's about 2 inches a week in the summer. Now that's a reference ET rate. The reference is how much water would a cool season grass that's 4 inches tall in an open field use. So a cool season grass in an open field that's 4 inches tall would use 1 inch a week in the spring and the fall and 2 inches a week in the summer. Many of the lawns we grow are cool season grasses, like Marathon and Medallion. They are tall fescues. They are cool season grasses. So if you are growing a tall fescue, and most people are these days, you will use about an inch a week in the spring and the fall and 2 inches a week in the summer. And if you add that up, that's nearly 4 feet of water per year to keep your lawn alive. That's a whole lot of water. Nothing uses as much water as a lawn in a landscape. That includes pools. Swimming pools don't use nearly that much water. Nothing uses that much water. It's a tremendous amount of water. So you've got your ET rate. Next thing you need to know is your application rate when you're watering. If you have sprinklers, you can figure out your application rate in inches per hour by putting cans or cups on your lawn and turning on your sprinklers for 15 minutes, measuring the depth in the cups, multiplying times four, take an average of all the cups you put out there, multiply times four, and figure out how many inches per hour you're applying. If you don't know how many inches per hour you're applying, you don't know how long it takes you to apply an inch. Now, certain types of plants need to be watered at different frequencies, and it has to do with rooting depth. So let's talk about lawns again. Lawns are not deep rooted. Lawns are shallow rooted, maybe 6 to 12 inches deep. That upper 6 to 12 inches of the soil dries out very rapidly in the summer months, and it, you know, pretty rapid in the spring and the fall as well. So in the spring and the fall, you need to water your lawn twice a week. In the summer, in the hot inland valleys, you got to water your lawn every other day, three times a week. And so in the spring and the fall, you want to give them an inch a week in two applications. So you're going to put down a half an inch each time you water, and you're going to do it twice a week in March, April, May, and June. If we get hot in July, then you're going to start watering 2 inches a week, but you're going to need to put it down in three applications. Now, you don't really need to go over the full 2 inches. You can probably get away with an inch and a half to an inch and three quarters, because the lawn really doesn't need the full ET rate. It needs a little less than the full ET rate. So you can, for the most part, for hot inland valleys, for these tall fescues, you can apply a half an inch every other day or three times a week. Say you have an application rate of 2 inches per hour, which is pretty common for most pop-up sprinkler systems. You have about 2 inches an hour. And if you run it for 15 minutes, you're going to get a half an inch. So if you run your sprinklers for 15 minutes and get a half an inch and do that three times a week, that will be enough water to keep your lawn doing quite well in hot inland valleys. At the beach, your evapotranspiration rate is less. It's more like 3/4 of an inch a week in the spring and the fall and an inch and a half in the summer. In the desert, it rapidly goes up to 2 inches a week in the spring and gets up to 3 inches a week in the summer. So where are you exactly? Are you in a hot inland valley? Are you along the coast? Are you out in Palm Springs? You have to take that into account when you figure out how much water to apply to your landscape. Now, we've been talking about grasses. They are shallow rooted and dry out rapidly. Let's talk about trees and shrubs. Trees and shrubs are deep rooted to 2 to 3 feet. And don't need to be watered frequently. In fact, you want to soak trees deeply and then let them dry out for 2 to 4 weeks. So trees in general should not be planted in lawns. They have a direct conflict with how to water the lawn and how to water a large tree. So for large shade trees, many of our trees we grow in Southern California are Mediterranean trees. They are native to the Mediterranean, they're native to maybe South Africa, they're native to Southern China or to areas with a similar climate as ours, a Mediterranean climate. They can go dry all summer, in fact, but in order for them to thrive and do well in the landscape, they should be deep watered once a month in the spring and the fall. And depending on the specific tree, you could water every 2 weeks in the summer. Now, some trees, like eucalyptus, you can just water them once a month, pretty much spring, summer, fall. Other trees, like a citrus, you're going to need to water once a month in the spring and the fall and every 2 weeks in the summer. These are all guidelines. They're not chiseled in stone. If you have a sandy soil, you may have to water a little more frequently because it's not going to hold very much water. If you have a loam, then these guidelines are probably just right on for you. If you have a heavy clay, then you're going to want to water even less often. So in the summer, you might only water every 3 weeks because heavy clays retain their water for a long time. So they're guidelines, and you need to adjust them to your soil and where you live and what you're watering. Now, shrubs that are drought-tolerant shrubs, things like rosemary or Indian hawthorn, Raphiolepis, or think of some other really tough shrubs that just don't need a lot of water. You can water them once a month in the spring and the fall and every 2 weeks in the summer. But when you water those types of plants, whether they're big trees or shrubs, you want to give them 3 or 4 inches of water. Now, for a regular pop-up lawn sprinkler system that applies at 2 inches an hour, you'd run it for an hour and a half to 2 hours. That's a long time. But in order to really soak the soil to a depth of 24 inches to 36 inches deep, you have to put down 3 to 4 inches of water. And that's what you want to do when you're watering fruit trees or large shade trees or many of the shrubs we grow. Now, some shrubs are not real drought tolerant, and they're going to need to be watered once a week in the summer. Rose bushes, fuchsias that are, you grow along the coast in the shade, you're going to need to water them at least once a week. So you have to adjust all this. If you're growing really drought-tolerant materials, junipers, rosemary, Raphiolepis, things like that, really, really drought-tolerant, then you're not going to need to water them every week, every 2 weeks in the summer, once a month, spring and the fall, every 2 weeks in the summer. So we've covered evapotranspiration, we've covered application rate, and then what I was getting at in the last few minutes was what we call the crop coefficient. That is, certain species require a certain percentage of the ET rate back in order to do well. And so, lawns need nearly 100% of ET. Their crop coefficient is really, well, it's actually 80%. So they need 80% of whatever they lose back in order to do well. This crop coefficient for citrus is 66%, two-thirds. So they, if you're losing 4 inches a month in March, then you need to give them about two-thirds of that. And now I said 3 inches for citrus in the spring. That's 75%, but you're in the ballpark. You just want to be in the ballpark. You don't want to be wasting water too much. You don't want to be drought stressing your plants. You want to be in that middle where you're watering just about right. It's often said in Southern California, there's two ways to water, too much and too little. You don't want to do that. If you drought stress your plants, you're going to have poor performance. If you water them too much, if you're watering too frequently. And that's often people said they've been overwatered. What does that really mean? How do you overwater? You water too frequently. That's what it really means, or it should mean. Because if you water too frequently and you keep the soil wet all the time, you're going to get root rot. You're going to have poor conditions for the roots to grow in. So you deep water, let it drain and dry out over 2 to 4 weeks, and then water again, depending on the season and what you're watering. So that's kind of watering in a nutshell. You've got evapotranspiration, you've got application rate, and you've got a crop coefficient. So some crop coefficients may be as little as 10%, like cactus. You give them 10% of what they lose on a monthly basis, and they're doing fine. So you soak, water them once a month or once every couple months, they're fine. Oak trees, native oaks, California coast live oak, which is the most commonly grown oak in Southern California, can go dry all summer. Its crop coefficient is really 0%. You don't need to water them in the summer. You can water them in January, February, March, April if you want, once a month, and give them 3 to 4 inches of water every time you do it. Soak them good. Now, you don't need to do that if it's rained. If we had a lot of good rain in December, January, or February, you really don't need to water oaks. But this last winter, we only had 5 inches downtown Los Angeles. That's almost no water. That's like getting nothing. So oaks are going to be drought stressed pretty bad through the summer months if you didn't water them during the spring in a drought year. So it's important to water drought-tolerant trees during drought years in the spring months so that they're fully hydrated as we go into the summer, especially if you're going to let them go dry all summer. And you can, with many trees, let them go dry all summer. So now I want to take a look at some video clips. Let's go to our first video clip. This is about troubleshooting your irrigation system. It's called How to Test for Landscape Water Waste. And this is important. A lot of these pop-up sprinkler systems, not only are people turning them on every day for 10 minutes, which wastes a tremendous amount of water, but the system itself is not operating properly, and you're wasting water. It's going down the sidewalk, into the gutter, and down into the storm drains, and that's just a tremendous waste of water. We can't do that anymore in Southern California. Let's take a look at this video clip, how to test for landscape water waste. Do we have our clip? I guess maybe something's holding up the clip. So what you need to look for when you are inspecting your irrigation system is you need to look at each head and make sure it's spraying towards the lawn and it hasn't turned and is spraying on the sidewalk itself. You need to make sure that they're spraying and not clogged, because lawns need complete coverage. Do we have the clip yet? Maybe you could send me... Okay, let's try our video clip now.
It's Bud. I'm an irrigation specialist with the Pasadena Water and Power Conservation Program. Welcome to our video on how to tune up your sprinkler system and measure your outdoor water use. I will guide you through how to measure your water use, show you where you might need improvements, and some better ways to water your lawn and garden. The first thing we're going to do is check for leaks around the house. A leaking toilet or sprinkler valve can waste hundreds of gallons of water every day. So first, check around the house and be sure all the water is shut off. A good way to see if you have any leaks is to simply look at your water meter. See the small black triangle in the middle? It turns for every tenth of a gallon. If it starts and stops, that's good. If it slowly creeps along all the time, that's bad. It means you might have a constant leak somewhere. When was the last time you watched your system run? Heads tend to get blocked, clogged, and broken. So first, let's walk around and see how this system's doing. I see a couple of things in this lawn right away. This brown spot is not caused by a lack of watering, but instead the head is plugged. Here's another one where the head is turned. It's keeping the sidewalk nice and clean, but missing the lawn. And here's one that is completely blocked by plants, preventing the water from reaching the lawn. Now you can buy extensions to raise these heads up, or you can simply cut back the plants, clearing the path for water to reach its intended area. The last most common problem is that the sprinkler head has the wrong nozzle, causing the water to shoot way over its intended area. So the first thing we did was to watch our system run. Then we straightened, unplugged, and unblocked any heads that are giving us problems. Now we're ready to measure the system's efficiency. To do this test, we're going to need 6 cans or cups, all the same size. I'm going to use these small plastic cups. We also need a ruler and a pencil. As you can see, I'm setting up the cups out in the middle of the lawn, in the main watering zone. Try to set them within one zone if you can, and not too close to the heads. Now I'm going to turn the zone on for 10 minutes. We'll see a lot of things happening as it runs. First, the cups are obviously catching water, but some other things are happening as well. Do you see the mist in the air? This tells us that the water pressure is too high and should be turned down. And over here, the zone has only been on for a minute or so, and already we have water running off the lawn. It's sad to know that landscape runoff is the largest single cause of water waste in Southern California. After running the zone for 10 minutes, gather up the cups and lay them out so we can measure the amount of water in each one. Take a ruler and stick it in each cup. We can see that two of them have about a third of an inch, two have about half an inch, and two have almost none. We're not done yet. Write down the amount of water in each cup. The two almost empty ones tells me that this area is not getting enough water, and that means low uniformity. You end up overwatering the entire area just to get these areas wet enough. The right thing to do is to correct the nozzle size or unplug the head so these areas get wet faster. Now we're going to combine all of the cups into one. Grab your ruler again and measure the depth of the water. This is how much water we're applying each hour. In this case, it is roughly 2 inches per hour. That's a lot. Is that good? Well, no, but it's very common. Your soil absorbs water at about 0.2 to 0.6 inches per hour, a whole lot less than the 2 inches per hour we're watering at. So what happens when you water this fast? That's right, you get water runoff. There are guides available to help you set your controller for the correct amount of water based on the kinds of sprinkler heads you have. For more information, please visit our website at PasadenaSavesWater.com. There are a number of things you want to look for throughout the lawn and garden that may help you know if you're overwatering. Is your lawn squishy? If so, it's too wet. Are there moss and mushrooms growing in the lawn or garden beds? If so, your lawn is too wet and collecting too much moisture. Are there stains in the streets and gutters where water's always running off? Or are there standing puddles in the same places all the time? These are all signs that you may be overwatering your lawn. Also, look for any brown or dead spots. This tells you that there's either no coverage in those spots or the head might be plugged. You may even need to add a head for better coverage in that area. I hope you saw some things in this video that can help you improve your lawn and got you thinking about the big causes of water waste. Remember, in Southern California, 60% of all the water we use is used on our landscapes. And never just turn up the watering time to make a brown spot go away. Always fix the problem. I've given you some tips you can do yourself, but landscaping is a craft. For professional landscape advice, we suggest you contact a licensed landscape contractor. I'm Lawrence Budd, and by using these tips, you'll have a healthier, greener lawn that saves water and money.
So there are some really important things to learn from that video. One is that the cups, putting out the cups. You can use straight-sided coffee cups. You can use tuna cans or cat food cans. You put them out. I say run the system for 15 minutes. He said 10 minutes. It really doesn't matter how long you run it. The idea is to calculate how many inches per hour you're applying. So that's how you learn that. The second thing is you will learn uniformity. If you put out 10 cans and all the cans get about a half an inch, but one or two, then you realize that there's something wrong with one of those heads. It can be clogged, it could be turned and facing the wrong direction, all that kind of thing. So that's important to learn that. And you have to know your application rate to know if you're putting down enough water, because every time you want to run your system to water a lawn, you want to give it about a half an inch. Now let me just backtrack for a moment, because I forgot to talk about one other thing. And that's about the structure of this class. So the point of this class is to learn about gardens of California. What do we grow in these gardens? What kind of plant material do we grow in California? How do you take care of those types of plants? So we're going to look at citrus. We're going to look at palm trees. Palms have become a signature plant for Southern California. We're going to look at major tree diseases, because they have shaped the history of America and the history of the world, actually. And we get new ones, and they are going to dramatically impact us in the future as well. We're going to look at all these different types of plant groups. We're going to look at plants you can grow in your garden that are appropriate for where you live. And that's part of what we're doing today, looking at watering, because I'm about to tell you to tear out your lawn and get rid of it. It's wasting water. It takes a lot of effort to mow it every week. You got to fertilize it all the time. Southern California is one of the worst places ever to grow grass. Unless you have a real practical reason for having a lawn, you should tear it out and grow something else. It doesn't have to be mowed every week, doesn't have to be watered every week, two or three times a week, and you will save an awful lot of water. But let's talk a little bit more about the class. So we're going to have, I believe, 14 classes. I will lecture every week on a plant group or some aspect of gardening. We will highlight some things for you to go and do. Today we didn't talk about upcoming events, but we will always start the show actually with upcoming events, places you can go and hear lectures on gardening, lectures on plant materials. And we're going to have two exams, a midterm and a final, and it will cover the material we cover in each class. And I'll ask you questions like, how do you figure out the application rate for lawn sprinklers? And you need to tell me. You put cans on the lawn and run it for a time period and then calculate your inches per hour. I'll ask you, what is a crop coefficient? I'll ask you, what is evapotranspiration? I'll ask you, what plant material uses the most water in a landscape? And you're going to need to tell me, grasses and lawns use the most water in a landscape. So that's the class. The questions will be taken directly from the lecture. The one other requirement we have is that you go to an outside event. You go to a botanical garden, you go to the Huntington Botanical Gardens, you go to the Arboretum, you go to the Fullerton Arboretum, maybe you go to San Diego Botanical Garden. Go to one that's closest to you and most convenient. Attend an event there, either a class or a lecture or a hike. And it doesn't have to be from the ones we highlight at the beginning of the show, but you need to go to an outside event and learn something about gardening and write an essay about what you learned, and then you need to email that to me. And it's and I'm going to post the syllabus on Monday, and if you email me, I can email it directly to you as well. But pretty much your grade will be based on the two exams and your written essay. You can do a second essay, a second outside event, for extra credit. So you can go to two events and write them both up. The second one's not worth as much as the first one. And then by calling in and participating in the show, you also get points for that as well. So you can call in and ask questions about your own garden. Hopefully, I'm sparking your interest in your own garden, and there's something about your garden you'd like to ask me about. The other thing I wanted to mention before we move on and talk a little bit more about watering is my own background. I mentioned that I have my Bachelor of Science in Botany from Cal Poly Pomona and my PhD in Plant Pathology from Cal Poly Pomona, I mean from UC Riverside. But after I finished my doctorate, I was a curator at the Huntington Botanical Gardens for 3 years, or almost four, and I curated the camellia collection there. And I also acted as a plant pathologist for the garden, so other curators would bring me a diseased plant material or damaged plant material and want to know what was damaging or what the disease was. And then I went over to the Arboretum, and I was at the Arboretum for a couple years as a research horticulturalist. And then in 2000, I moved over to the Agricultural Commissioner Weights and Measures Department for the County of Los Angeles. And I am a senior biologist plant pathologist, and I run a plant diagnostic laboratory in Southgate. And of course, anyone can contact me at my laboratory and ask me questions about their gardens, or say, what I see on my garden, what's wrong with it? You know, I've got holes in my leaves, I've got curly leaves, I've got a dead tree. And then you can send me samples. People email me photographs of their gardens or their trees and want to know what's wrong with them. And we also have an entomologist in our department, Dr. R. Kalian, who can identify insects for you. And he is a little more reluctant to tell you control options. I'm not. I will tell you exactly what to do to control the pests in your garden, because I think that's what I'm paid to do. I'm paid to help people with their gardens. Now, the purpose of our division within the Ag Commissioner's office, it's pest exclusion. Our purpose is to keep bugs and diseases and weeds and agricultural pests out of California, because there's a tremendous influx of plant materials into the state from other states and from other countries. And what happens is when those plants arrive, they've either got insects on the plants that we don't have currently in California, which become serious problems, or they have diseases on the plants that we don't have in California, which become serious problems. Or they might have weeds or nematodes. Now, nematodes are microscopic worms, some of which feed on plant roots. The vast majority of nematodes are free living. 80% live in the ocean, actually, and most of those in the soil are free living, and they don't feed on plants. But there are some that feed on plants, and they're really bad agricultural pests, and so we're trying to keep them out. That's my job with the county, is to assist the public and gardeners, but primarily to try and keep bugs and plants and pests that would harm the environment or harm agriculture out of California. And LA County is kind of a center for the introduction of new pests. We've got the airport with tremendous traffic coming in there. We've got the port of Long Beach and San Pedro, both those ports with tremendous cargo coming in from Asia, from all over the world. And invariably, it brings with it insects, plant diseases, all sorts of things. And keeping them out is not only difficult, it's extremely difficult. And we're looking for little tiny bugs sometimes that can, when their populations get big, be really serious pests. So let's get back to watering again. You know, that last clip was, you know, had a lot of good information in it that you need to inspect your system. It's really a good idea to turn off all the water in your property and go out and look at your water meter, and it should not be moving. If it's moving very slowly, something's leaking. A toilet could be leaking, a valve in your sprinkler system could be leaking, something like that. And so you need to address that, because that's going to run up your water bill like crazy. Not just wasting water, but wasting your money, your hard-earned money. So address that first. Now then, take a look at when your sprinkler system is going on. Is it spraying water on the sidewalk? Is it all running down? So these are all really important. If you're managing your own garden, you need to get a good firm grasp on how to irrigate your garden and how to save water, or how to not to waste water at least. So it's not uncommon for people to call me and they tell me something's dying in their landscape or something's doing badly. And the first question I ask them is almost always, how often are you watering that tree or your lawn, or how often are you watering? They say, oh, every day for 10 minutes. Nothing gets watered every day, except seedlings in little tiny pots or clay pots in the heat of the summer. You may water those daily, but you don't water lawns every day. You don't water fruit trees every day. You don't, you know, if you're watering things, in fact, fruit trees, you don't water them two or three times a week. You water them every month in the spring and the fall, and every 2 weeks in the summer, and you soak them deep. So the most common problem I find from home gardeners is not knowing how to water. That's why our first program is about watering. Now, I've got another video clip on watering. It's a little long, it's about 11 minutes, but it's an important clip. And this is actually from, I believe, the Seattle area, Kings County, up in Washington. But this is a very good clip, and I wanted to take a look at this. Water-wise landscapes, manual and automatic sprinklers, and scheduling. So let's take a look at this video clip. And she has a lot of good tips, and there's some additional information in this clip that wasn't in the last clip. So let's take a look at this clip. I hope it's ready to go.
If you don't mind a little exercise, a manual sprinkler can be a very efficient way to water, as long as you follow a couple of guidelines. Try to find a sprinkler that matches the area you want to water. Many sprinklers have spray patterns that can be adjusted. And oscillating sprinklers tend to water with larger droplets, so less water will evaporate. For very small areas, between hard surfaces and structures, it may be easier to water by hand. A common source of leaks is where the hose attaches. Over the watering season, this can really add up. These leaks are usually caused by a worn out or missing washer. This is an easy repair. There are two types of washers, flat and O-ring. Installing an O-ring washer will generally fix the leak. Great! No leaks. The biggest problem that most people have with a manual sprinkler is forgetting to turn it off. You can buy a simple timer like this one that will automatically shut it off. If you use a timer, you must also install a vacuum breaker between the timer and the hose. The vacuum breaker ensures that no contaminated water can accidentally be drawn back into the plumbing of your home. As far as determining how long to run your manual sprinkler, watch the scheduling section and we'll show you how. Manual watering is a hands-on and effective way to water. If you're an avid gardener and in tune with your landscape, it's a great option. Now let's move on to automatic sprinklers. Automatic sprinklers make watering convenient, but there are opportunities for problems. We're going to show you what to look for and how to address any problems you find. It's important to inspect your sprinkler system at the beginning of each season and monthly after that. Damage can occur from lawnmowers or vandalism or through normal wear and tear. If you don't check your system frequently, you may not know you have a problem. Before you begin your inspection, visit our website and download a system inspection form. Sprinkler systems have four main components: the backflow prevention device, the controller, underground lines, and sprinkler heads. The backflow prevention device keeps contaminants from being drawn through your sprinkler into your home's plumbing. Check with your water utility to learn about requirements. Controllers, also called timers and clocks, come in many models, but they all perform the same function to run your automatic sprinkler system. To do your inspection, you'll need to run your system for a short time. Many controllers have a test option that will run each area for about 2 minutes. Now let's make sure we understand how to use this feature. Turn the dial to the test mode. The display will show test and the time each zone will run. The default runtime is usually 2 minutes per zone. This should be enough to do the inspection, but you can increase or decrease the runtime by pressing the up or down arrows. Next, press the start button, and we're ready to start the inspection. For most residential systems, sprinkler heads come in two basic types: pop-up spray heads and rotor heads. Pop-up spray heads are usually used in shrub beds and small lawn areas. Rotor heads are more often used in large lawn areas. The two types vary in how much water they apply, so you should know which type you have. You should also check every sprinkler you have in your system to make sure they're working properly. Now we're going to take a look at some of the common problems. Sprinkler heads can be knocked off by lawnmowers and weed trimmers. This is a major waste of water and is unhealthy for your plants. If you find a geyser, turn your system off and call an irrigation professional right away. Overgrown shrubs can block the spray. In most cases, this is a really easy fix. Simply trim back the plant. If that is not an option, an irrigation professional can install a riser or move the sprinkler to another location. Sprinkler heads can be turned the wrong way, applying water to the pavement or against your house. You can usually fix this by rotating the sprinkler head back to its correct position. However, if the sprinkler head won't easily turn, don't force it or it could break. If the system pressure is too high, the sprinkler heads will mist and the water will evaporate. This can be fixed by lowering the system pressure, but that's a job for a pro. Runoff occurs when the soil cannot absorb the water fast enough. This is a common problem, especially if you have clay soil. You may be pouring expensive drinking water down the storm drain. To prevent runoff, use the cycle and soak feature on your controller. We'll show you how to do this later. As you perform your inspection, keep an eye out for wet spots where you wouldn't expect them. These can indicate a leak in the underground line. If you find a spot like this, contact your irrigation professional. Another indication of a leak is a zone where the pressure seems too low. If the water from the spray head is dribbling, you may have a leak in the underground line. Sprinkler systems water different areas of your landscape in sequence. These areas are called zones. In a well-designed system, each zone contains plants with the same water needs. However, your system may have zones that include both grass and shrubs. These are called mixed zones. And if you water enough to keep the grass green, you're probably overwatering the shrubs. If you have mixed zones, you can remove either the grass or the shrubs, or you can have an irrigation professional separate the areas into two zones. In some cases, it may be easier to shut off some of the sprinkler heads in the beds and water the shrubs by hand. You can shut off some sprinklers by tightening the screw at the top of the sprinkler head. This is usually a pretty simple task. If you have any problems, turn it over to a professional. As you can see, there are plenty of things that can go wrong with your sprinkler system. The key is observation. Get to know your system well and inspect it every month. If you find problems, take care of them right away. This will keep your plants looking great and your water bills from getting out of hand. Scheduling determines how long your sprinkler runs and how many days a week. The first step is to figure out how much water your sprinklers apply. Start by placing 10 empty tuna cans spaced equally in the area you're going to water. After you put out the cans, go to your controller and turn on the sprinklers for 15 minutes. First, choose the zone where you've laid out the tuna cans. Next, use the up and down arrows to set the time for 15 minutes. Now press start. Once your sprinkler has shut off, take a ruler and measure the depth of the water in each can. Calculate the average depth of all the cans and multiply that number by 4. This is your sprinkler's hourly watering rate. Now you can go to our website and download a worksheet to calculate your own customized schedule. The schedule you create is based on how much water your sprinkler applies, but you can fine-tune this schedule by looking at the soil after you water. Grab a shovel and see how deep the water went. Water should go 4 to 6 inches deep each time your sprinklers run. If the water only went 3 inches deep, increase the run time by a couple of minutes. If the water is going below the root zone, decrease the run time. You may have to experiment a little to make sure you're getting water to the right depth. Soils in some areas of King County have hard pans or blocking layers only a few inches deep. This can make a big difference in how you water. If you dig your shovel into the ground and it feels like you're hitting pavement, it's likely a hard pan. If you have hard pan soil, you won't get water to go very deep. Unfortunately, you either have to water for shorter times, but more frequently, or undergo a major innovation to improve your soil. Also, pay attention to rainfall. King County typically receives a significant amount of rain in the spring, and you may not need to run your sprinklers at all until June or July. Let the soil be your guide. If there's plenty of moisture in the soil, don't water.
So she had some really good points there. One, if the soil's moist, you don't need to keep watering. Now, it's important, you know, that if in December and January and February, if we get good rain, then you don't need to water for that week or for even 2 or 3 weeks. So it's cold in the winter. The plants are not very active. They're not using a lot of water. So one good rainstorm with an inch of water is usually good for a couple weeks. If, you know, so you can turn off your system in December, January, and February most winters. Now I see we have a caller. Let's go to our first caller. Terry calling from South Pasadena, or from Pasadena, I mean. You're on the air.
Question about my snap peas. I had sugar snap peas I planted last year.
Okay.
And it looks like they got some mildew on them. And I wanted to know how do I prevent that from happening?
Okay, well, that's a timely question because we're going to talk about the pea family and peas today and snap peas. And one of the more common problems on them is powdery mildew. It usually is worse if they don't get enough full sun. So it's important that you grow them where they're going to get full sun all day or as much of the day as possible. If you grow them in the shade where they get a half day shade, then the mildew problem will be more severe. There are a couple ways to control powdery mildew. Now, powdery mildew is a true fungus. There are many different species of fungi that cause powdery mildew. So the powdery mildew you get on your roses is not the same fungus that gets on the peas. And the powdery mildew that gets on crepe myrtle trees is not the same that gets on the roses. They're all fairly host-specific and fairly narrow host range, although the one on roses does go to peach because they're both in the rose family and they're related. But how do you control it? So number one, there are two sprays you can use. One is milk and water, and milk and water works pretty good. You can use any type of milk product. You can use powdered milk, skim milk, non-fat milk, whole milk, any milk product, at anywhere from 10% milk and 90% water up to 50% milk and 50% water. If I've been told by people who have tried it that it works very well and that they use the non-fat milk and they get no smell of sour milk. So if you use a whole milk, you may smell a little sour milk from the application after a few days. And it's not the milk directly that controls the powdery mildew. It's the milk coats the leaf, and bacteria and fungi grow in that actually inhibit the powdery mildew. So it works quite well. It's non-toxic. It's cheap. But you do have to spray fairly frequently. You're going to spray on a 10 to 14 day schedule. The problem with controlling powdery mildew in general, whether you're using a broad spectrum fungicide or if you're using milk and water, is that the new growth won't have the protectant. Powdery mildews only infect the epidermis of the first couple layers of cells in a plant on the leaves and the stems. So they're right on the surface. So they're actually exposed and you can control them. But the new growth won't be covered with that, and it's susceptible. So after a week or two and you grow new leaves, they can become infected because these products, either the milk and water or a broad spectrum fungicide, which I haven't talked about yet really, are foliar protectants. They coat the leaf and protect it from infection. The other product that's now out there is potassium bicarbonate, and Kellogg has registered a fungicide that the active ingredient is potassium bicarbonate. And potassium bicarbonate is non-toxic. This is an organically labeled fungicide specifically to control powdery mildews. And so between the two, with milk and water and potassium bicarbonate, you should be able to get very good control of any powdery mildew, whether it's on pea plants or rose bushes or whatever the problem is. You should be able to control it with those two. Now, you might want to alternate your sprays. So 1 week use milk and water, next week use potassium bicarbonate. Although I don't think you'll likely to get resistance with either product. It's always good to change, not keep using the same thing over and over again.
Okay. Well, thank you for all that information. I'll use it.
Okay. Thank you for calling, and thank you for watching the show. So, yeah, powdery mildew is one of the more common problems on peas, especially if they don't get a lot of sun. And it's really critical that you grow them in the full sun, or you won't get as much flowering and fruit production. If you grow them in the shade, they'll be leggy, they won't be as strong, and they'll be more susceptible to powdery mildew. So we were talking about watering, and I think we've really covered it a lot. Just a little more about watering, and that's how water moves in the soil. And let's talk a little bit about soil. Soil is composed of the living part and the non-living part. The living part would be insects and mites and worms and nematodes, which are microscopic worms, all the living stuff, and any organic matter that's decomposing, that's colonized by fungi or bacteria. Then there's the mineral part, or the non-living part of the soil. And that is broken down by particle size. So there's clay particles, there are silt particles, and there are sand particles. And that's based on size. And that's the texture of the soil is influenced by the percentage of those three groups, silt, sand, clay. Clay is the microscopic particles, silt's a little bigger, and sand is the biggest particle. And then, of course, after that, you have gravel and rocks. But if All three of those have equal influence on the texture. It's a loam. That's what you mean when you say you have a loam. It means equal influence. It's not equal percentage, because clay has a disproportionate influence. So that really means only about 20-25% clay, and then equal portions of sand and silt. I'll bring in the soil triangle at some point. We'll look at this a little more carefully. The point is that if you have a 30% clay soil, you have a clay soil, because clay has a disproportionate influence. But clay soils retain water and don't drain well. Sandy soils don't retain water and drain rapidly. Loams are right in the middle. They retain water, but they drain well. So loams are your best soils. When you're irrigating, you should know that. Because if you're irrigating a clay soil, you don't have to irrigate as often, because it's going to retain most of its water. If you're irrigating a sandy soil, you have to irrigate more frequently, because it's going to drain and the water is not going to be retained. You can improve your soil by adding organic matter. That's the best thing you can do for a soil, is add organic matter, mulch and compost. It's really good for the soil. Increases your fertility, increases water holding capacity, and it's just the best thing you can do. So now, the other thing is that the soil has different sized pores in the soil. If you have a very heavy clay, you have mostly micropores and not a lot of macropores or big pores. If you have sand, you have all macropores. The point is that the water drains from macropores to the micropores by capillary action. So that's why sands just drain and don't retain the water, because they have no micropores. Clays have very few macropores. They just have the micropores, and they hold the water. So the soil, so that's how it moves. It moves from the big pores to the small pores, and the small pores really hold on to the water. So that's important to remember. That's very important to remember when you're watering or when you're planting new plants, because when you take a 5-gallon pot or a 1-gallon potted plant, or maybe a 15-gallon potted plant, that soil mix in the pot is mostly macropores. They've used a very, very light mix. They'll use a mixture of perlite or vermiculite or sawdust and peat moss, and they make up a potting mix depending on what they're growing. They don't usually add in any clay. They don't add in sand or silt all that much. It's mostly non-soil things that they use to make up their potting mix. So when you plant that in the ground, it's almost all macropores. If you cover the top of the soil with regular, the root ball with regular soil, the water will tend to enter the soil, go around the root ball, and not enter the root ball. So one of the reasons you lose new plants, even though you're watering them, is because you covered the root ball with the natural soil, and then the water won't enter the root ball. It just wicks around it in the micropores. So remember, when you're planting a new plant, plant it with the root ball about an inch above grade, and you can cover that with mulch, but not with soil. So because when you water it, you want the water to go into the root ball. It will drain out of the root ball into the bulk soil, into the native soil, but it's not going to go the other direction. If you soak the native soil, it's not going to go into the root ball, because those are macropores, almost exclusively macropores in your root ball, because of the way potting mixes are made. Now, let's talk about the pea family, because it is nearly the end of summer, or at least the middle of summer, and now we're going to move in to the fall and the winter months. And this is when you can grow a winter garden. So what should you be doing as we get ready for the winter garden? Well, you should start pretty soon preparing trellises if you want to grow peas. I love peas. They're easy to grow. They're one of your best winter crops. The other winter crops you can grow are the coal crops. Cabbage, broccoli, cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, and spinach. These are all excellent winter crops. And all the lettuces, the head lettuces, You know, lettuces, when you grow lettuce in the summer, they grow quickly because of the heat and the long days, and they flower, and they bolt. They send up a big, long flower, and then the leaves become bitter. So winter is a great time to grow all the different lettuces. And you can get, it's easy to grow from seed. You don't have to buy it in pots. You just sprinkle the seed out into the ground. They come up like crazy. You thin them to like every 6 to 12 inches. You can grow leaf lettuce. You can grow head lettuce. The other thing I like to grow in the winter is cilantro, because in the summer cilantro has immature leaves, which is cilantro, and the mature leaves that look like a fern, very lacy, and then it flowers and the seed is coriander. So the best time to grow cilantro is the winter. So these are the winter things. When can you start planting your winter garden? Well, about mid-September is the best time to start seeding in your winter garden. So that's just a few weeks away. And now you want to take a look at your summer materials and decide if they've got any more yield potential for the rest of the summer. Some of the things, this heat can be pretty hard on them. Depending on what you're growing, if it's starting to, you know, come to the end, go ahead, tear it out, or plan on tearing it out in the next few weeks, and then preparing that area of your garden to grow either peas or the lettuce or cauliflower, broccoli, Brussels sprouts, all the winter materials. Now, the rest of the United States grows these things in the spring. We grow them in Southern California in the winter. But you need to get them in early. If you plant them in mid-September or up until about mid-October, the soil is still warm and you're going to get good root growth and good shoot growth right before we get a little cold. If you plant them in November or December, the soil will have cooled off a little bit. The days are shorter and they're colder, and you're not going to get much of a good head start. So it's best to start your winter garden materials mid-September and into October, and then they'll come up. They'll start to get a little, maybe 4 to 6 inches tall, and then we're going to get into the cool season, but they've already got a root system, they've already got some shoots up, and that's how you get your head start. But let's talk about the pea family, and let's take a look at the pea flower, which is our photograph number 5. Let's bring that up full screen, and you can take a look at the pea family, or the pea flower. Bring that up full screen, because families are often delineated by the actual flower. The flower is the same across the whole family. So pea flowers have what we call bilateral symmetry, which means you can cut them right in half and they are mirror images of each other, but you can only do it on one plane. Whereas a sunflower, you could cut it in half anywhere, so it's got radial symmetry. So the back petal is called the banner, the front is called the keel, and here are your stamens. And there's the pistil. Let me clear that, because here's the pistil right here. Few stamens. The wing is here. And here's your pedicel. And the calyx is made up of all the sepals. So that's your basic pea flower. The other thing about peas is most of them are bipinnate. Leaves most often are even or odd pinnately compound or bipinnate. So let's take a look at number 6, and this is a typical leaf from a pea plant. And this is Tipuanu tipu, which is a large tree. The pea family is the third largest plant family behind orchids and the sunflower family. And I'll show you what I mean by pinnate and bipinnate. So let's take a look at this right here. And let's talk about what a leaf is, because we haven't talked about that yet. This is a little piece of a branch, and this is a leaf. This whole thing here is a leaf on this particular tree. This is a pecan tree. And how do I know where, this is called pinnately compound leaf, because the leaf itself is broken up into leaflets. And at the base of the leaf, there is a bud, and everything beyond the bud is the leaf. So if we take a look at this, if we go to our overhead, and I'll try and show you this. Let me pull off another one. Can we go to the overhead? And let me show you. Right here, there's a little bud right there. So everything beyond here, and if we take a look right in here, You can see there's a little bud right there. So this is the pedicel, and this whole thing is the leaf. And each one of these is a leaflet. There's no bud at the base of the leaflet. If you look right here, there's no bud. So this whole thing is the leaf. Okay, and this is called pinnately compound. If the leaf is entire, then it's not lobed or subdivided. Now let's take a look at another tree. This is a mimosa, or Albizia julibrissin, which is a pink-flowered, wonderful tree. And this is the leaf. And the bud is right here on the stem. But let's take a look at this. This is called bipinnately compound. And if I pull this here, this whole thing is the leaf. And it comes up, and then another midrib comes off, and then the leaflets come off of that. Compare it to this. Here's the leaflet. But it's not. This is not subdivided into little leaflets, whereas this is. This is pinnately compound. This is bipinnately compound. Each one of these is a little leaflet. Well, it didn't want to come off very easily, but so this is bipinnately compound. This is very common in the pea family. Almost all peas are either pinnately compound or bipinnately compound. I can't think of any that aren't, to tell you the truth. So let's just talk a little bit more about the flowers. The flowers always have 5 generally fused sepals, which are the calyx, and 5 free petals. They are generally hermaphroditic and have hermaphroditic, meaning they have both sexes, and have a short hypanthium, usually cup-shaped. There are normally 10 stamens and 1 elongated superior ovary with a curved style. Leaves most often are even or oddly pinnate. The ovary most typically develops into a legume, and there are 2 names for the pea family: the leguminosae, which is the old name, and fabaceae, which is the new modern name. And if you haven't, I know I didn't get the syllabus out last week, but I'll have it out next week. So you need to read a little bit about the pea family. You can read about peas themselves in the Sunset Western Garden book, and you can read about Fabaceae, the pea family, on either Wikipedia or some other source. So you know a little bit more about the pea family. It is the 3rd largest of all the families behind the orchid family and the sunflower family. Very, very large family. The other really giant family would be the grass family, the Poaceae. Almost all legumes or pods, the pea family make pods. All the members of the pea family make pods. Usually the fruit opens along a seam on both sides. So think of a pea pod or a bean pod. Another interesting thing that the pea family does is almost all members of the pea family, their roots have an association with bacteria that are called rhizobia bacteria. And the rhizobia infect the roots and make root nodules. And the root nodules are little bumps on the roots. And if you cut into them and they're working properly, they'll be pink inside. And what's happening inside is the bacteria is inside that nodule, and it's converting nitrogen in the air into, because 80% of our atmosphere is nitrogen gas, is converting the nitrogen gas in the atmosphere to fixed nitrogen, I believe it makes nitrate, and then the plant can use the nitrate as a nitrogen source. Plants cannot use nitrogen gas as a nitrogen source. Now, nitrogen is one of your key fertilizer elements. The 3 macro elements for plants are nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, and they're always listed on every fertilizer bag. NPK, there's 3 numbers, 10, 10, 10, meaning 10% nitrogen, 10% phosphorus, 10% potassium. Well, soils are almost always deficient in nitrogen. Nitrogen is soluble and it leaches from the soil readily, and so you almost always need to add nitrogen into the soil to have a good yield or have good healthy plants, depending on what you're growing to some extent. So rhizobia is the genus of this bacteria that infect the roots of pea plants, not just the pea itself, but all the pea family, whether it's beans or peas or these big trees. And then they're able to do nitrogen fixation. So the history of legumes, or the pea family, is tied closely to that of human civilization, appearing early in Asia and the Americas. The common bean, several varieties, and beans used to be one of the main staples, and still is today, a main staple across the world, especially in Europe. And beans and peas were used as early as 6000 BC, where they became a staple. Essential for supplementing protein, because beans and peas are very high in protein. If you're a vegetarian, beans are one of your best sources of protein. So beans are one of the longest cultivated plants in the history of man. Broad beans have been grown at least since ancient Egypt, and the common bean for 6,000 years in the Americas. So beans, I believe, are one of the three sisters. The three sisters were beans, corn, and squash by the Native American Indians. And so they would grow corn, and then at the base they would plant beans that would curl up the corn, and then all around that they would grow squash to inhibit weeds. So those are the three sisters. So beans are one of the three sisters. There are over 4,000 cultivars of bean. So I can't even start to talk about all the beans that are in the pea family because there's so many of them. And that's just in the United States alone. 4,000 different cultivars of bean in the United States. So what do I mean by cultivar? That's a term that you might not have heard before. Cultivar is short for cultivated variety. And now I probably need to digress just for a minute and talk about plant names. This is always important for you to understand what I'm saying. A plant name. There's a common name, like California Coast Live Oak. That is the common name for that oak tree. The botanical name is Quercus agrifolia. The botanical name is made up of two parts, the genus, which is Quercus, and agrifolia, which is the specific epithet. The two together comprise the species name. Now we can compare that to humans. Our genus is Homo, and our specific epithet is sapien, which means wise, which is debatable. But together, you put them together, Homo sapien, that's our species. Now there are varieties of plants. They can occur naturally, and they're just called a variety. Or they could be selected by man or hybridized. You may take beans and cross them and get a different looking plant, still a bean, but now it's called a cultivated variety or a cultivar. And a good example of that would be in roses. If you go by a rose bush, it will have a name like Chrysler Imperial or Mr. Lincoln or John Kennedy or whoever, you know, developed that particular plant and then cloned it and grew it up, and now you know that John Kennedy has a white flower, or Chrysler Imperial has a deep red flower that's heavily scented. But that name, Chrysler Imperial, is the cultivated variety. And that can be very important in gardening, because when you go out to buy a rose bush, you just don't want any rose bush. You want a specific, you want a red flowered rose, or you want a heavily scented rose, or you want a white rose, whatever you want. So you're going to buy it by the cultivated variety name or the cultivar name. So in that sense, there are 4,000 cultivars of beans grown in the United States. Well, staggering to think how many different beans there are. Most of the kinds commonly eaten fresh come from the Americas. Beans are one of the three sisters. I don't know that peas so much are one of the three sisters. I think it's mostly beans. Now, the pea plant itself is Piscium sativum. The wild pea is restricted to the Mediterranean basin and the Near East. Earliest archaeological finds of peas come from Syria, Turkey, and Jordan. I always find the history of plant materials to be really, really interesting. So in Egypt, early finds come from about 4,800 to 4,400 BC in the Delta area, and from 3,800 to 3,600 in Upper Egypt. In early times, peas were grown mostly for their dry seeds. In modern times, however, peas are usually boiled or steamed, which breaks down the cell walls and makes the taste sweeter and the nutrients more bioavailable. Along with broad beans and lentils, these formed an important part of the diet of most people in Europe during the Middle Ages. You know, protein from animals is, you know, it's a great source of protein if you eat meat. It's the richest source of protein, is meat. But meats are hard to keep. They spoil, and so you need refrigeration. So if you go back hundreds of years, people weren't able to eat meat a lot because it was hard to keep meat fresh without it spoiling. But beans, if you dry them, they'll keep, and keep them in a cool, dry spot, will keep for months and months and months, if not for years. And then, so during the winter months especially, you can have a tremendous source of protein that's easily cooked and prepared. By the 1600s and 1700s, it had become popular to eat peas green. So you can eat them fresh before they get hard. New cultivars of peas were developed by the English during this time, which became known as garden peas and English peas. Thomas Jefferson grew more than 30 cultivars of peas on his own estate. Many cultivars reach maturity about 60 days after planting. So if you plant your peas at the end of September, October, November, you can have fresh peas in December and serve them at your Christmas dinner, maybe even at Thanksgiving, your own, grow your own. Now, peas are a cool season crop. You don't plant peas in the spring in Southern California. It's because by the time they come up and they're starting to make their fruit, it'll be too hot. So they're planted in the fall and grown through the winter months. The seeds may be planted as soon as the soil temperature reaches 50 degrees, with plants growing best at temperatures of 55 to 65 degrees. So that's why we grow them in the winter, and in the rest of the United States, they grow them in the spring. The snow pea is a Picium sativum, a variety Macrocarpo, eaten whole in its pod while still unripe. So those are sugar snap peas and snap peas in general. Cultivated in a region that is now along the Thailand-Burma border as long ago as 12,000 years. So another ancient crop, really. So snap peas, also known as sugar snaps. you know, this is the edible pod. An edible potted pea is similar to a garden or English pea, but the pod is less fibrous and edible when young. So there's two really kinds of peas you can grow. The ones where you break open the pod and eat the peas, or the ones where you eat the whole pod. And I really like sugar snaps. I think they're just fabulous, and that's one of my favorite things to grow in the winter. There's a lot of different cultivars of snap peas: Sugar Ray, Sugar Bond, Sugar Ann, Sugar Snap. They go on and on and on. And I stopped by this morning, and I stopped at a Home Depot on the way in this morning, and here's a sugar pea. This was about $4 for this little pack. I don't know how many are in the pack. It's by the ounce probably. But you take a look at this from the overhead. And these are sugar snap peas. These are snap peas. And you're going to want to support these on a trellis. They are not going to support themselves. All the peas have to be supported. But you can see, you know, this is the package I bought this morning. I want to plant these in a couple weeks. Well, I want to put my trellis before I plant them because I like to be prepared. I find that if I put stuff in the ground and I'm not really completely ready for it, before I know it, things are going bad for me. So I have a video clip talking about how to grow peas. Let's go to our next video clip, which is peas, care and harvest. And we'll take a look at this video clip, and it'll show you how to build a trellis for your peas. Maybe I can just say a few more words while they get that video ready.
Tall, and it's time to start trellising them. Last year I tried to trellis my peas, but my trellis ended up flopping over, and I think it really hurt my yields. So today Danielle's coming over to show me a couple different methods for trellising, which will hopefully give me a better harvest.
Hey, Sarah. Wow, this warm weather's been really good to your peas, huh?
Yeah, the tall telephone peas seem to be doing the best. They're a couple inches high. The British Wonder peas have been a little slow to come up. They're just poking out now. And then after you left, I also planted some sugar snap peas because I really like to mix those with regular peas when I'm cooking.
Well, they look really good, but they're a little still on the short side.
I know you said a few inches, but I'm about to go out of town for a week, and I'm worried that if I wait to get back to stake them, that they could be a little too tall and be a tangled mess.
Oh, yeah. We don't want to fight against that. So, all right, well, let's start with our first way of staking, and we're going to build a trellis.
Okay.
To build an ultra-strong trellising system, you're going to need a couple things. First, you're going to need some wooden stakes, at least 6 feet tall. Next, you're going to need some sort of trellis netting. This is available at most garden centers. You're going to need some brackets, some screws, and as far as tools are concerned, you're going to need a cordless drill and a staple gun. Here's how to install it. First, dig your stakes down as deep as you possibly can into the raised bed. Attach each of the wooden stakes to the opposing sides of the raised bed with the brackets. This will ensure that your trellis won't topple over. Next, with the help of a friend, staple down the side of one stake, attaching the netting. Go to the other side, pulling as taut as possible, and staple it. Once the netting is tight and stapled, cut off the excess. You can leave an extra bit of netting towards the bottom to help the peas climb. All right.
Wow, this is so much more sturdy than my trellis last year. This is great.
Woohoo! Yeah, I know. It better not fall down. Okay, so what you're going to want to do in a couple weeks, Sarah, or maybe a few days if the weather stays warm, is train these peas by just weaving them in and out to begin with. And then they should grow up just like that and really fill in the trellis.
Great. Well, so that takes care of the telephone peas. Now, what about the other ones?
Oh, the British Wonder peas? We're actually going to construct some teepees for those.
Oh, okay. I've done that before, last year for my vining vegetables.
All right, let's get started.
To make teepees, you take four of the bamboo stakes and push the ends into the ground as far as you can. Two legs should straddle each side of the pea row. Gather all four ends together and lash them together with twine.
Sarah, here's a quick tip for you. You're going to want to, when these get a little bit taller, actually several inches taller because these are the stubborn wonder peas, attach them to the legs. And the easiest way to tie them to the legs is using this.
Pantyhose.
Yeah!
Because I knew they were good for something.
So they expand and stretch, and then you just cut it into strips.
So why are pantyhose better than any other type of plant tie?
They'll expand as the plant grows and not cut off the circulation of the stem. Mm-hmm. So just a loose little tie.
Okay, so I should be able to do that when these guys get a little bit taller. So what about the sugar snap peas?
Well, we kind of have two options for these low-growing peas. One is the block method, and it basically consists of running string around the outside and letting the mass all grow up together and try to support itself.
That sounds like kind of what I did last year, and that didn't work. So what else do you have?
Yeah, it's a little dicey. So the other method is called the pea brush method, and for that, we need to go visit your brush pile.
I just spent all last week dragging this stuff out of my garden, and now you're having me bring it back in? What's up with that?
Trust me, there's a plan. So all you need to do for this method is gently insert the branches among the pea sprouts, trying as best you can to avoid crushing any of them. So the point of the pea brush method is to basically create a brambly mess right down the middle of your pea patch. So Sarah, that looks really great. Now what we can do is that we can trim back some of these really crazy branches, and then all we have to do at that point is probably wait for them to flower and start picking pods.
Can't wait. The other great thing about these trellises, they'll keep Juno out of the peas.
Yay, so hopefully we'll have a good harvest.
Hopefully. Hooray, it's finally time to harvest my peas. I think it is anyway. Danielle, how do I know when it's time to harvest my peas?
See, Danielle, you told me to start looking for pods when I saw the flowers, and we've got lots of pods now.
Yeah, look at them. They look great. They're awesome looking. I can't believe how much they've grown in just a few short weeks. All right, so let me show you how to tell whether or not your peas are ripe and the pods are ready to be picked.
Okay.
For shelling and sugar snap peas, you want to look for three different things. First, you want to make sure that the pods are swollen and plump, so when you squeeze them a bit, they feel full and really firm. Second, you want them to be full size. Shelling peas are usually 2 to 3 inches long, and sugar snaps are a bit smaller, only topping off at about 1.5 to 2 inches. Third, you want them to have a bright green outer shell, not dull and waxy.
about this one? It's sized up really well, but it's still a little skinny.
Yeah, this one's a little immature yet, because feel it, you can feel that the peas on the inside are pretty teeny tiny still. Yeah.
Okay.
You want to wait for them to plump up.
Okay. I think this one might be a little far gone. What do you think?
Oh yeah, this is a perfect example of a pea that really has gone way too overripe. See how it's kind of dull and waxy on the outside? It's really pale in color. And the other thing is, it's so plump, it looks like it's gonna burst open and the seam has already started to show really prominently.
Uh-huh.
This guy's definitely overdone.
Yeah, even Juno's not a fan. I think that one's going in the compost.
Yeah, to the compost pile with that one. You want to be careful about the time of day that you're harvesting, too.
Oh, well, is it okay to pick them in the morning like this?
Yeah, morning is actually best because the sugar content is the highest at this point in the day.
Oh, well, speaking of which, I have a few kitchen tips to preserve the sweetness of them. So let's finish picking these up and go inside.
Yay, I finally get to cook!
Yeah!
So that was a good way to build a trellis. I'm not so wild about that brush technique, sticking sticks in the ground to hold up your peas. I would use a trellis. You can buy plastic netting or you can use twine to tie between the sticks. You want to use a good sturdy piece of wood probably attach it to something. If you've got raised beds with either 2x4s or 2x6s, you can attach it to that. You can brace it. When these plants get tall, they get heavy and they can pull the trellises down, so you gotta really make sure they're sturdy. A couple things about peas that are important is whatever pea package you buy, you can look at the back, it'll tell you how to plant them. Planting depth, 1 inch. And row spacing, 4 feet, 48 inches between rows. If you're gonna have multiple rows of peas, you need 4 feet between rows. Plant spacing is 3 inches. It says seed spacing 2 inches. I would say I would just go ahead and plant them about every 3 inches. And so this is these are the snap varieties, and there's many different name varieties or cultivars of snap peas. And those snap peas are the ones I like, but there's also shelling peas. And this is, here are two different ones. This is Oregon sugar pod. This is another sugar snap pea that I got at Home Depot this morning. And this one is the Alaska. And it says 55 days to harvest on this one. That's pretty quick. And in the back here, it'll say days to harvest is 65 to 70 for the sugar peas. This one is also 65 to 70. So that's why I suggest you plant in mid-September. The soil's warm, they'll come up quickly. It tells you on the back of the package as well how long to sprout, 14 to 21 days to sprout. That's kind of long. I think they'll come up in 14 days. This one says 14 to 21. This one also says 14 to 21. So you can expect to take about 2 weeks for it to even come up after you plant it. And then it'll be October, and we'll be getting into the cold nights or the cool nights and into the fall weather. So you want to get them up before it gets too cold, or you'll be waiting until February to pick your peas. Now, the other thing to grow, and let me see if I have any other things in my notes I want to talk about. Sweet pea, that's what I want to talk about now, sweet peas. So sweet peas are not grown for eating. They're grown for the flowers. In fact, you can't eat them. It's Lathyrus odoratus. And sweet peas are spectacular flowers that are highly fragrant. And they're easy to grow. And again, you want to start them in a few weeks. Then by December, by Christmas, you'll be cutting sweet pea blooms and bringing them in and putting them on your table when you're having guests over. So. Now, they are native from Sicily to Crete. They're Mediterranean. They've been highly hybridized, so there's many colors and many named cultivars. They've been cultivated since the 17th century, and like I said, there's a vast number of cultivars. And I've got one package here. Now, this one's just kind of a generic package, so I'll just show you this one. This is sweet pea, multiflora mixture. These are the trailing part. There are new cultivars of sweet peas that are bush. They only get about 12 inches high. I'm not thrilled with them. I tried to grow them 1 year and I wasn't thrilled with that cultivar. I want to grow them on a trellis. They'll easily get 8 feet tall. They get covered with blooms. They need to be out in the full sun. And it says back here, minimum of 8 hours a day of full sun. And in general, when you're growing vegetables, that's true. You want a minimum of 8 hours. It's better to get 10 or 12 hours of full sun. For things like fruit trees, whether you're talking about your summer vegetables, your tomatoes and peppers and and things like that, squash, you need lots of full sun if you're trying to grow fruit. Now, if you're trying to grow just leaves, herbs, you can tolerate a lot more shade. So, but you can't when you're trying to get flowers and fruit. You need a lot of energy, you need a lot of full sun. So sweet peas need to be in the full sun. I like to grow sweet peas on a south-facing wall or fence. They'll do great on a chain link fence, for that matter, and they'll just be spectacular all through the winter months. So let's take a look. We have a picture there. Let's go to number 9, and I'll show you some of the colors you can expect from peas, from the sweet peas. Now, they are not edible. They will make you sick if you eat them, so you cannot eat sweet peas. Bring that up full screen, and I just want to see the color in here. This is scarlet sweet pea. The last one that was just up a minute ago was a nice lilac or a violet color. I'm not the best with colors. Let's take a look at number 10. Just run through some of these pictures of sweet peas. Here's Sunshine Opal is our next one, number 11. And then Sweet Pea Rose. Let's take a look at Sweet Pea Rose. If you're really, really motivated and want to grow a tremendous amount of sweet peas, you can do this. But look at this trellis system that they built to grow their sweet peas. It's quite elaborate. And that's multiple rows. And that's about 4 feet between rows, and the plants are about 3 inches apart. Then you could probably go even farther apart, maybe 4 or 5 inches apart. Let's take a look at some other colors. Number 13, this is Burnished Bronze. And this is just a general sweet pea picture, number 14. And you can see the different colors. Now remember, these are highly fragrant. When you walk by these when they're blooming, you're going to fall in love with them. Number 15 is another just general sweet pea color. You can see the different colors. And one packet will give you many, many different colors. Now you can also order them by cultivar. So you can go online and find a lot of different nurseries from around the world that sell one color. So you can grow all reds or all pinks or all purples if you want to do that. If it matches the color of your home, if you're into this whole concept of matching your flower colors to your home color, which is kind of a basic thing of landscape architecture, is matching the color of your plants to the color of your home. Maybe you want all white flowers, so you want to grow all white sweet peas. I'm not so tied to that. I just want to grow them and enjoy them. But there's a lot of other pea plants that you can grow. The pea family is the third largest plant family. So let's take a look at a couple other things that are in the plant family in addition to peas. Let's take a look at number 16, the mimosa tree. Bring that up full screen. Now, these were blooming back in June. Mimosa, I believe it's native to South America. I showed you some. They are bipinnately compound. Let's take a closer look at the flower, number 17. And that's the flower. Now, you get those in June, and they're really, really pretty, especially from above. And there is only one problem I know of, and I don't see it very often. They do get fusarium wilt, which is a fungal disease that kills them. And I saw that on some mimosas in Pacific Palisades a few years back. So that's the mimosa flower there. And it's Albizia julibrissin is the name of the tree, the botanical name of the tree. And the common name is mimosa. And then Tipuanutipu is another tree we grow in Southern California, and that's also in the pea family. We take a look at that, that's number 18. And that's Tipuanutipu. Now that's a little one, they get really, really big. Another member of the pea family are the acacias. Let's take a look at Acacia baliana. And acacias are native to both the Americas and Africa, and are very, very drought tolerant. If you look closely, you'll see that that leaf is pinnately compound. Now, some other pea members are common vetch, number 20, and of course, this has the typical pea flower. And this is something you should take home, is to recognize pea flowers, and you'll recognize that the plant you're looking at is in the pea family. A lot of times you'll be in a garden, you'll be maybe in a botanical garden, or just walking down the street, and you'll see a flower and you'll think, oh boy, what is that plant? Well, if you can recognize the family, you're that much closer to knowing what plant you're looking at. So the pea flower is very distinct and it's easily recognized. And then clover, Trifolium repens, bring that up full screen. Now clover is also in the pea family. That's a head of little tiny pea flowers. And pea flowers, or clover, I should say, is often grown in between crops as a cover crop. So one of the things you could do, say you don't want to have a winter garden this year, but you have a summer vegetable garden every year, what do you do with that space? Do you let it just go fallow all winter? Or do you grow a cover crop? Well, clover would be an excellent cover crop. You could seed it in, and then in sometime in February, just turn it into the soil, and you will be adding nitrogen to the soil very, very easily without using a fertilizer. I mean, if you want to be kind of natural or organic, that's a great way to increase the fertility of your soil without using certainly synthetic fertilizers. Of course, you can always use organic fertilizers, things like cottonseed meal, blood meal, bone meal, kelp meal, the meals. They're all, you know, organic sources of nitrogen and other mineral nutrients as compared to nitrogen salts like ammonium sulfate or ammonium nitrate, which you can't buy ammonium nitrate because it blows up and they don't want to give it to anybody. Now, we have about 10 minutes left, and we've covered most of the pea family pretty well. And of course, the reason I'm talking about the pea family is because you grow peas in the winter. Now you grow beans in the summer. I want to emphasize that. As we're going into the fall and you're planting your winter garden, you have to grow winter materials. And the summer materials aren't going to do well. So beans are a summer crop. Now the bush beans that stay real small, I like those. But I'm not a big fan of the dwarf type sweet peas. I like the trellising sweet peas. You get more flowers and the others didn't perform that well. Now I'm going to change gears a little bit. I want to talk about a new pest we have in Southern California. And this is a very, very important pest. Originally, this was called the shot hole borer, or the tea shot hole borer. It's a little tiny beetle. I mean, teeny tiny little beetle. And historically, it's been known to attack tea plants, Camellia sinensis, especially in Sri Lanka and India, where the bulk of tea is produced in the world. And this little tiny beetle it burrows into the trunk of the tree and lays its eggs, and the eggs hatch, and that's a beetle gallery, and then they feed inside the tree. Unfortunately, this beetle is what we call an ambrosia beetle, and that's a group of beetles that carry fungi with them in their mouth parts and infect the tree with the fungus. And the larvae actually eat the fungus, so they don't eat the tree. And this particular beetle I'm going to show you showed up a few years ago. I think the first place it was found was probably down in Southgate on Avocado, but it was actually, I know for sure that it was at the Huntington Botanical Gardens before that. And this beetle now is attacking quite a few different trees. Probably about 25 trees serve as reproductive hosts, which means the fungus will grow in the tree and the larvae will eat the fungus and complete their life cycle and emerge as adult beetles. So let's take a look. So what happens is the beetle goes in, and let's take a look at the first picture on Avocado. This is Avocado canker. Let's bring up the Avocado canker, which I think is photograph number 24, and bring that up full screen. Now these beetles enter the trunk of the tree and they're going to avocados, they're going to oak trees, they're going to a whole lot of different trees. I can't even think of all the different trees, but it starts off probably right in one little spot, and then it introduces this fungal pathogen into the wood of the tree, and that creates this big infected zone or a canker. When the trunk of a tree or a branch of a tree is infected by a pathogenic agent like a bacteria or a fungus, we call that a canker. So this is a bleeding canker. This white you see in here is produced by the tree right there. That's actually a sugar that the tree produces in response to a wound. The canker is this whole area. Now, if we take a look at the next picture, this is also Avocado canker, number 23. You'll see each one of these is an individual strike by a separate beetle. This is a serious problem on avocado. It's been a big problem on avocado in Israel for many years. Eventually, the cankers get quite large. The entire trunk will be infected, or the entire branch. And then, like, this branch could just break off and fall on the ground. The first thing you'll see is this white fluffy stuff being produced by the avocado. Take a look at 24. This white stuff here is actually a sugar produced by the tree. All you have to do is poke a hole in an avocado tree and it'll make this white fluffy stuff. So any kind of wound will do it. But that's telling you might have this beetle attacking your avocado. Unfortunately, it's going to a lot of other trees. Now take a look at 25. We'll look at some other cankers. And I believe this is an avocado. Yeah, this is an avocado as well. These are all individual strikes. And this one is at the Arboretum. This is widespread now in the San Gabriel Valley, all the way down to Long Beach. And nothing's going to stop it from spreading. If you cut into the canker, you can see in number 26, the actual infected wood. Here's the infection. So there's no treatment. Once the beetles are in the tree, you're kind of in deep trouble. So let's take a look at the beetle itself. Now, originally we were calling this T shot hole borer. Let's go to 27. This is the beetle itself. It's extremely small, about probably no bigger than a 16th of an inch. And it carries in its mouth parts right in here two different fungi, it turns out, a Fusarium species and a second species. I can't remember the genus right off the bat. I've forgotten the name of the second species. But so you get these two fungi growing in the wood, and that causes the canker. One other pest. Now, what can you do to protect your avocado? Unfortunately, not a whole lot. And you can either spray the trunks in the spring with a pyrethrin, and you might have to spray as much as once a month, to keep this shot hole borer. Now, it was called the T shot hole borer. Now they're calling it the polyphagous shot hole borer. If you're growing avocados, if you're worried about your oaks, your sycamores, maples, it particularly likes maples, like Acer Negundo is the box elder, it's a maple, but sugar maple will also get it. What's the silver maple will also, all the maples are highly susceptible to the shot hole borer. And I'm just calling it shot hole borer to keep it simple. So you could spray the trunks of your trees once a month with a pyrethrin, which is organically labeled. Or if you want to use something stronger, you could use 7, which may very well work as well. Next week, we don't have a show next Sunday or a class next Sunday, so we'll be back in 2 weeks. I will be posting the syllabus. It's not that complicated. It's a pretty straightforward class, 2 midterms, an outside project. You've got to go to an outside event. You can do it twice for extra credit. Calling in during the show also gets you credit. We like to know you're out there. And I'm certainly, some of you must have a question about how to take care of your garden. Find something weird and call me. You can email photographs into the show as well. We'll bring them up on screen and talk about it. We can talk about how to prune your trees and the proper way to prune large trees. Now, I think we're coming to our last minute. Maybe we can go to the overhead and I'll show you one more bug that's a big problem. This is called the brown marmalade stink bug. Let me get him on his, here, let's go to the overhead and see if we have time to say goodbye. Well, next, in 2 weeks, we'll look at the brown marmalade stink bug. This has been Gardens of California. Thank you for watching. See you in 2 weeks.